Thank you. Respected guests and all the dignitaries, as well as all the delegates attending this symposium, it's my privilege to introduce Dr. K. Radhakrishnan sir, former chairman ISRO, as well as secretary DOS, who will be giving this 29th Vikram Sarabhai Memorial Lecture on behalf of the Society of Remote Sensing. Introducing Dr. Radhakrishnan sir is like showing a lamp or a candle to sun. Suraj ko diya dikhane jaisa hota hai. He needs, in fact, no introduction. Dr. Radhakrishnan was chairman of Space Commission, secretary of Department of Space, and chairman of ISRO from November 2009 to December 2014. He provided strong and successful leadership to the 16,000 strong team ISRO for 37 space missions, including several historic feats in Indian space endeavor. Most notably, his credit for steering India's first planetary exploration mission to Mars or Mangalyaan from concept to fruition within 4 short years, establishing India as the first country to have successful mission to Mars at its very first attempt, and at a significantly low cost. He has been an astute institution builder with a strategic vision, an able and diligent administrator, a dynamic and result-oriented manager, and an inspiring leader credited with nurturing leadership in the younger generation. An electrical engineer.
Please display a picture of Dr. Radhakrishnan, sir.
An electrical engineer inducted into ISRO in 1971 at Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, Trivandrum. Dr. Radhakrishnan studied management at IIM Bangalore and obtained doctorate from IIT Kharagpur. So you can see the varied span of his career, especially the learning career. He has done management also. He has done doctorate in Earth Observation System. So as Dr. Sivan sir was pointing out, he is a most capable person of addressing this august audience today under this Vikram Sarabhai lecture series. He held key roles in avionics system, technology management, space economics, and space applications for almost 3 decades. He rose to become director of chain of remote sensing regional centers by 1989 and mission director for National Space Application Mission during 1997 to 2000. During the stint of 5 years at Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services, INCOIS, as a founder director, he became vice chairman of Intergovernmental Oceanographic Commission of UNESCO and the first project director of India's tsunami early warning system. Back again at ISRO in 2005, he headed the National Remote Sensing Agency till 2007 and Vikram Sarabhai Space Center during 2007 to 2009. Dr. Radhakrishnan sir is a fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering and National Academy of Science India and member of International Academy of Astronautics. He is bestowed with Padma Bhushan in 2014, the third highest civilian award of India, L&D Memorial Award of IAF, and 50 more awards and accolades. The Nature Journal chose him as one of the 10 people who mattered in the year 2014, being a very eventful year of our launch of our Mangalyaan mission. His biography, My Odyssey, Memoirs of the Man Behind the Mangalyaan Mission, co-authored with Niranjan Raut, was published by Penguin India Random House in 2016. Recently, Dr. Radhakrishnan is honorary distinguished advisor in Department of Space ISRO, chairman of Board of Governors of IIT Kanpur and IIT Roorkee, as well as chairman of the Standing Committee of IIT Council. Also, is a member of the Advisory Council of Dr. Pranav Mukherjee Foundation and honorary member of UAE Space Agency International Advisory Boards. Known for his great oratory and brevity. In fact, I am not suggesting him to limit his talk because we are very keen and eager to know about these Earth observation paradigm shift in applications and services. And especially as Dr. Sivan said, this is an apt moment when India is opening up its space sector for private sector. It will be our great opportunity to listen to Dr. Radhakrishnan sir about the various Earth Observation System, how the system is going to evolve further in this era of opening up of space sector. And in fact, ISRO, as ISRS has been promoting, ISRO is not only Chandrayaan, Gaganyaan, but we have been doing societal activities related to Earth observation, communication and navigation also. And in fact, the day could not be very far when ISRS as a society may also approach ISRO for launching its own Earth observation satellite, as Sivan sir was mentioning about startups and other private sector. So with this, I once again welcome Dr. Radhakrishnan sir and thank him for agreeing to giving this Vikram Sarabhai Memorial Lecture, which has we have started this series by ISRS in 1992, with the first lecture being given by late Professor U.R. Rao sir. And then almost all the known doyens of Indian space program as well as Earth Observation program like Dr. P.R. Pisharoti, Professor Yashpal, Dr. M.G.K. Menon, Dr. Kasturi Rangan sir, Dr. Dixit Lu, Muthu Nayagan sir, Dr. Vinod Gaur, Dr. Kelkar, Dr. P.S. Goel sir, Dr. Bhatia, they have given lectures on varied topics in all these last 28 years. So with this, once again, we welcome Dr. Radhakrishnan sir and invite him for giving his opening remarks related to our ISRS National Symposium and then to initiate this Vikram Sarabhai Memorial Lecture. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. And good afternoon, distinguished Chairman ISRO and my beloved colleague, Dr. Shivan. Nilesh Desai, Dr. Rajkumar, Rajiv Jyoti, Prakash, and I see the presence of Dr. Shailesh Naik and Dr. Vivian Krishnamurthy, my long-term colleagues, all the members of the executive committee of both ISRS and ISG, as well as the fellows, its participants who are present here today. In fact, I'm extremely happy to join my old family and my association with community has been direct association has been of almost 24 years and I cherish I found that I do something for the society through the medium of remote sensing. Here will be helping me to put those slides and I request him to do so. In the meantime, let me also compliment the organizers for making this mammoth competition possible COVID and ensuring participation of especially the young researchers from various parts of the country. And today, I'm extremely happy to deliver this Vikram Sarabhai Memorial Lecture. And the topic that I chose today is changing paradigms in Earth observation, applications, and services. And I shall try to focus this towards the theme of the conference. Can I have if you have a parcel of this journey, a legacy of forward. And I recall two papers. In 1979, ISRO brought out a document with the seminal speeches and writings of Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. And one of them was on his vision for Earth observation and applications for land, water, ocean, etc., etc. To say in the year 2003, when Dr. Shailesh, Dr. Jayaraman, and myself were looking at the requirements of ocean to satellite and what we should do, I found still whatever he had written in this paper in the late 60s were still yet to be done, especially the area of ocean and atmosphere. And that is the forethought, that is the vision that person carried along with his great colleagues like Professor P.R. Pisharoti. In 1991, when we had the launch of IRS 1B, there was a special issue of Current Science brought out. And the last article there of remote sensing, historical perspectives and reminiscence by Professor P.R. Pichardi. So he writes how this program was started, and most of you know that in 1969, it started with that famous coconut wilt disease detection in Kerala. That was a phase of demonstration and using data from the available Landsats and spot systems. But we got into the next phase by year 1988. That is where we had our own IRA satellites. We were into thematic mapping, possible with that kind of resolution. And generally, we talk about 1:50,000 scale for those maps. But it was done in several themes. And the great idea of this NNRMS, National Natural Resource Management System, that was conceived by Professor Dhawan along with Professor Yama Swaminathan and Professor N. G. K. Menon, which is really the USP of India's remote sensing application program today. And by 1999-2008, we got into another phase where we started making OceanSat, CartoSats, ResourceSats, thematic satellites of a specific nature. And we also got into that institutionalization, whether it is in forestry or in ocean. And from merely mapping and looking at the picture for visual or digital interpretation, people started, especially meteorology, oceanographic area for parameter retrieval. And there, physics got into, science got into, mathematics got into, more than interpretation techniques of statistics. And by 2009-2020, we had seen great being done, especially with inclusion of strategic constellations, the CartoSat series, RISAT 2 series, and the CartoSat 3 of the recent past. And we got into the another dimension comes to the data products. In olden days, to wait for 1 month, get agency, and it was a great favor that NRSA has been doing to them by giving it at that time. It was standard product. But later we got into the concept of actionable products, products which have got values added to it, and products which are delivered on the web within a few minutes from the receipt of the satellite data, and became very useful for disaster management and such applications. The most successful where people in various parts of the country could access the data and to do with this. That is a new phase. Now, question is, what is the future? And before coming to that, let me just tell you what is happening elsewhere in the world and what have been our aspirations and the perspectives. Can I just go to the next slide, Mehul? In the year 1997-2000, PhD work, and was some strategies for the management of Indian Earth Observation. And I was looking at some of those conclusions. One of them says, in the far future, that is 2005 to 2025 period, Indian Earth Observation System would have an optimized mix of EO satellites in polar and geostationary orbits, providing high resolution, 0.5 to 2.5 meter panchromatic imaging with stereo capability, multispectral imaging with a spatial resolution of 20 to 50 meter, continuous imaging with a spatial resolution of 250 to 500 meters with multispectral capability and a microwave component, and small satellite systems of 10 to 100 kg applications. In study came through a lot system channelized in a process of study. And if you look at what is happening today, and we are in 2020, we will see that most of the projections that we made in the year 1999 stands. Next one. Mehul, next one. This is the global scenario that have emerged in the last couple of decades. On one side, you will see global orchestration and synergy, Earth observation system, Earth observation is global, and everybody need not repeat. So the Earth observation satellite COOS came in 1984, and today we have our DAS being a member of it. India has been an active participant of this 34-member body, and we have been also chair of COOS for several years, and it still continues to be active. And then came in the 90s, the UN orchestrated observation systems, global observation system on climate and terrestrial observations, 91, 92, 96. Had an opportunity to be closely associated with the global ocean observation system, and later Dr. Shailesh also came into that position. And the 2000 plus, the Earth observation system of systems, GEOs, which has almost 102 member states participating, and all in bodies, voluntary bodies, contribute to the concept of GEOs. So as a total system, this has been a great development, and COOS still continues to be the expert group to provide information and wisdom on the satellite systems. Stating some of the pressing problems of this humanity, that was on sustainable development, came through a process, and finally in 2015 document sustainable development 17 goals in this. And if you look at the 17 goals, except four, which are like economy or society, all others require space systems, navigation or Earth observation, mostly Earth observation. And if you look at the disaster risk reduction framework that was signed in Sendai, Japan in 2015, there are several targets, seven targets, but they have focused on four areas. Risk, how to and how to institute and invest systems for that purpose. Again, India has made rights in satellite data for disaster management. And came the Paris Agreement on Climate Change in 2015, which is a binding agreement on all the nations who have been party to it, and which gives specific targets on the emission, trying to keep it at 2% level compared to the olden days of industrialization, and trying to prompt people to reduce it to even 1.5%. And the point here is, for all these international frameworks, Earth observation data is essential, unavoidable ingredient. And I will take just one example, which is related to this conference. Next slide, Mehul. Next slide, Mehul. This is on climate change, the footprints of climate change. And I was extremely happy to see, and many of these areas, papers are being presented today. I'm not reading it out. But one thing is very clear on global temperature rise. We say 2020 was the warmest year. And if you look at the global average compared to the previous century, the increase is 1.1%. But that is a global average. But we see the impact of it manifested by many of those factors which have been indicated here. Next one, Mehul. This is on the global climate observation system, where one needs information about the oceans, about the atmosphere, and about the land. Essentially trying to understand the interaction between ocean, atmosphere, and land in influencing the change in the climate. And if you look at the climate, it's a long-term phenomenon, you have to understand the variability over decades. And there, again, the information coming from Earth observation satellites are very crucial. And Dr. Shivan and his colleagues have been working on negative feedback for improving the system performance. But here is a classic case of positive feedback between ocean and atmosphere in space and time. So what the global community has been trying to understand is to tame this fellow. And what happens to the climate? What happens to the weather? What happens to the hazardous events? For the GCOS, the Global Climate Ocean Observation System, there are 54 essential climate variables identified through a global orchestration process. And 24 out of them are to be obtained from Earth observation data. And even our insights, our resource sites, our ocean sites, they all contribute to this essential climate variables used globally. Next one. Next slide, please, Mehul. Yeah. Now I will just speak about the paradigm shift that we are seeing today in the space segment, in the data availability, the data analytics, and the perception of the user. Technology has been advancing. And if you recall, in 1988, we had an IRS-1 satellite of 800 kilogram. And a few decades later, we had an IMS satellite, which also provided remote sensing data of similar quality. Technology has been enabling miniature satellites and complex sensors to be made. Same thing happens to the platforms, and we got the new capability for onboard processing of data for compression to start with, and later it became giving products which are processed onboard. In fact, satellites are becoming smart satellites. Micro satellites is another thing which has happened now. There are so many constellations for remote sensing, like what we have in communication. But I was fascinated by the NASA's recent satellite constellation, which is Cyclone Global Navigation Satellite System. And that takes the signals that are available from the navigation system, GPS systems, direct signals, and signals reflected back from the Earth. It's called waste signal or free signal or whatever it is. It's a novel idea. This also shows that you can, through novel ideas, optimize the expenditure on the resources to be put there. Synergistic observation across the electromagnetic spectrum. In fact, the NASA ISRO Earth Observation System is a classic example how we are trying to use S-band, X-band in one satellite system. And if you look at the data that comes from the satellite, we have been worrying how to have ground stations which are capable of receiving all this data. And today we talk about 3.5 terabyte data per day coming from the Sentinel 2A and 2B satellites. Next, Mehul. Coming to the Earth observation data availability and accessibility. Data is now freely available. First and foremost is an open sky policy. There it starts. And if you look at the countries, starting with the CBRS satellites, data became freely available. Now, even high resolution data up to a limit are available. Google Earth is a classic example of that. So there is a new era of Earth observation data with open and free regimes. There's a high temporal frequency at varying spatial scale. Time has become seconds or near real time, which enables rapid utilization of the Earth observation data. Again, the classic case is disaster management. Analysis ready and value added data products. We use a term called citizen scientist these days. That is, people who are not really professionals in that area contributing to the particular scientific area, like remote sensing. Fields have that we can really give an actionable product. And then coverage from local, very high resolution of 0.3 meter, 0.5 meter, to information at global scales, look at all phenomena. And more importantly, the quantitative algorithms for better parameter retrieval. So these are all the things which have happened. As Dr. Shivan said, this is an area where there is a lot to do from the community who are sitting today in this symposium. Next. This is on the data analytics and solutions. One is the multiple sources of space information from remote sensing, from GPS. We started talking about location-based services on mobile and the citizen science, which has added a new dimension to this. Crowdsourcing. Then cloud technology and automation tools, they are becoming very, very prevalent now, the machine and deep learning. But there is only one issue here compared to the other statistical data. If one has to manipulate the remote sensing data, earth observation data, one has to necessarily understand the physics and the biology behind it. It is not statistics or mathematics alone. And I still remember when we switched over in the 80s from the old visual interpretation to digital classification, there is a group of people who are dealing with only the DN values. And means this. So this is something which the new generation has really understand the physics or the science behind it. One cannot come to conclusions. And then there are several platforms today available for data analysis and solutions. Remote sensing is no more, or earth observation is no more in the realm of the scientific community. It is the community of the users. And monitoring of land surface processes in time and space has enabled another group of people who worry about looking at Earth as a total system. And the enhanced relevance of geospatial data and solutions for the governance. And in India in 2014-15, we saw all the government departments coming forward or prompted to use remote sensing data the way they can inject into their systems. And new models of data and information sharing is happening now thanks to the computer system. Next one. And we come to the paradigm shift on the user perspective. In India itself, it is very visible. And there is increasing participation by industry and startups. And optimization of data usage across natural resources, disaster management, governance, climate change, etc. And rapid rise in the share of information products and big data analytics. And people say earlier, the data used to come to the user. Now user goes to the data. User can go to the data store like you go to a hypermarket. Where all kinds of data is available about the entire Earth in cubes of resolutions from the 0.3, 0.4 meter to the scales that are required for global modeling. So this is the new paradigm that has come in data and application. And let me come to the last slide. India has been considered the role model for earth observation applications. And by 1990s, we also got into there as owners of a class of remote sensing constellation. And today, India is one of those countries which can claim to have varied type of earth observation satellite system. We should sustain, and with institutional synergy, India should be able to continue to be the role model along with the other community who are doing research in the area of analytics, data processing, etc. And with the structural reforms in the Indian space sector, utilization of EO products and services through private entrepreneurs, NGOs, startups, as poised take off rise rapidly. And I just want to conclude with saying, recently in an award committee, I saw one proposal of a startup who wants to use that concept of cyclone global navigation satellite system that is used in the base signal from the navigation satellite system for several applications what municipalities can do. In fact, this fertile minds are going to make a difference in the future, and that is a paradigm shift. Thank you very much for this opportunity to be with you, and it gave me some nostalgia, some updating. And I also thank my colleagues from the National Remote Sensing Agency who helped me to update myself for this process. Thank you, Nilesh, again for calling me, and Dr. Shivan for being there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for enriching us with your knowledge and wisdom. Indeed, it was a very informative talk to all our participants. Thanks once again, sir. We will now have virtual felicitation